Salon Leer. And this is the second event of a painting series we have, and this is why we have, on the one hand, painting two of the painting is the title of the series, and the guest tonight we have is the artist and painter, Paolo Piacera, and he's going to give a lecture about an essay he wrote for an exhibition he had in 2011 when you've been to the University at Oslo, and it was also part of an exhibition. The essay is called Painting One, so this is why we have Painting Two and Painting One together, and it analyzes and convergences, and he will give a lecture and present main topics and aspects of the essay, and then we will open for the audience and have a discussion, I think.
Yes.
Yes.
So thank you for coming. Welcome.
Thank you. Welcome. So thank you everybody for coming. I'm very happy, and thank you Tania and Ellen for inviting me. This book at the beginning for me was the idea to create a work for this exhibition that I had at the Oslo University on occasion of the anniversary, the 200 year of Oslo University. And it started a bit as an adventure, and at a certain point I realized that it was opening up a new somehow trajectory for my research. And in order to somehow explain or present to you my research, I would like to start with a consideration of methodological character. I'm an artist, and this evening I will mention concepts and words that are belonging to the world of philosophy. This could create maybe skepticism, because we are able to consider everything in regard of the scientific specialization. So every discipline has its own specialist. It is exactly in that direction that I turn in my gaze, in the moment in which, as an artist, I'm occupied in creating a relationship to give a direction of my experience, to collect different facts inside a sense. So philosophy is born as a logos, came originally from legein, means collect. And today philosophy finds itself in the modernity to have the position to lock, to understand that different perspective, that different specialization, that divided it remains not communicant fact. If you can talk about all the disagreement between poetry and philosophy, and Platone was saying Panagia diaphora. I would like to call to your attention the old agreement, so the Panagia symphora, that exists between these two different practices. As you might know, the word philosophy is constructed on the roots phos, phaos. If you think it's philosophia, it's philo, take care, and there is this sophia, who is constructed on the roots phos, which means light, and literally means taking care for what is strongly in light, in place where fantasy, that is a means that art is using for its goal, is constituted also on the roots phos, as a bring to light what is in the dark. So from the dark appears the light, and light is the idea, eidos, that means form, aspect, image. Image that is given in the flesh, but we call intuition, from intuiting, watching in, being in the image that is showed in its radicality as a non-apophantic content, to recall a term of the Aristotelian philosophy. A non-apophantic content is a content in itself, let's say white. The intuition recovers into the idea, eidos, is structure, is structuring, and so is limitation of that form, of that content. The artist decides of that idea, separating her from what it seemed to him different respects the perceived intuition. If we sign with a punct the intuition, and with a circle the developer's intuition, we see that the artist determines a series of decisions, the use of certain material with certain characteristics, obtaining a result, resultat, will say Hegel, but nevertheless is given in his immediacy as a non, as a semantic, non-apophantic, the painting. Okay, in front of the painting we are, but behind the painting, here painting one is asking about that. Which is the cause of the painting? Which is its principle? What may I see? This means go through the painting starting from its visibility into the direction that determinate that visibility. Rebring in light something that is in the dark, that means say painting is. And on this say I'm starting the problem. Painting one would like to talk about painting, that means say painting is. Translate the process of realization as a synthesis and division through the language, through veritable assertion, but are always a risk, an interpretation of the intuitive event. Emanuele Severino, is an Italian philosopher, underlined how the immediate date is always in relation to an interpretation, but relation doesn't mean identity. But the interpretation appears, and the appearance of the interpretation is not an interpretation. In the limit of my discourse, it's not possible place discursively the problem of the absolute truth. The book is a written book and is occupied about a content who is not written, but a draw one, a marked one. This is a problem because there is a difference between painting and writing. It doesn't correspond, or at least we can be sure about it. So both are manifestation of the idea, and from that idea are starting going far. In this regard, if we analyze the word Dichtung, penetrating the knowledge of the language, we see that it is badly translated as a poetry, and we see how the Greek rebring us to the word decay, which means justice, and literally means manifestating, indicating, where you can hear that play the word index. The Latin translation of dictum is dicere, which means manifestate, nominating. So dictum, it can be defined as a rational poetic thought. If you remember me later, we can look into the content, today really actual, of the dictum. But let's proceed underlining how search an identity between painting and writing is the first limit. In painting one, writing would like to evoke. The limit of the language and of that tradition that we call metaphysics are not, doesn't imply, the limit of the painting. We can't express by saying content that are beyond, that are outside the possibility of saying. But we can express the not being hidden of the painting, the not being hidden of the essence, like Heidegger would say, the unverborgenheit des Sendes. The meeting of tonight, if we give a look at the invitation, say, the work is a permanent luminous of itself. And this it seems bombastic. We are skeptic towards something that has this intention. It started the philosopher Marx saying, is existence determining the consciousness? Is existence, and so the work of the man, Arbeit, is a history, is a language, is a society, so we talk about Wissen sociology, is unconscious. There are a series of conditional factors where conditioning called to examine the concept of cause. And here, modern undeterministic science has its own point of view. However, the situation is the following one. Nevertheless, Marx itself admits, kind of contradicting itself, art it seems to show a certain stability, a permanence. He says that in the Grundrisse. talking about the Greek art and its capability to remain. And if we think that Leonardo, for example, no, was saying that painting is a mental thing, and the roots man of the word mind, it reminds that stability. Because on the roots man are constructed all the words that are defining the permanence, the manere, and what permain appear. So art and philosophy, for different means, using different means, are occupied on what is appearing or what appear. The being itself of the being in his luminous appear. Painting one utilizes very forceful writing to evoke the permanent content of the mind in its manifestation through the intuition. I like at that point to remember a phrase of that big enigma that is Friedrich Nietzsche. But in the Ecce Homo says, quote, "Hierarchy of power, distance, the art of separate without antagonizing, doesn't mix anything, doesn't conciliate anything, an enormous multiplicity that nevertheless is the opposite of chaos." That was the premises, the long secret work of my instinct. Is a superior protection is always demonstrated so strong but in any case, I even ever perceive what was growing up in me. And all my attitude are pop up one day all of a sudden, maturing all the imperfection. End quote. It is a painting that lives behind the limit of his description, through the luminous manifestation, toward a viewer but intend to visit it, to establish an empathic relation with it. We mentioned the word dictung as an indicating content, as an indicate through the index. We should watch the painting appear to us, going to the index, going where the painting is indicating. We should not renounce that fundamental experience. We should not renounce to the vision, to the pure vision, to go to the index, to leave the sign. Go to the index of the things itself, zu der Sage selbst, starting from the word of life, Lebenswelt. In Crisis of European Science, Edmund Husserl denounced how the abandon of that ground, the word of life, that science seemed ever lived behind. Science is based on the manifestation of the world, and still science is addressing the world and not its manifestation. Make things thematic, turn into index, sign, and here I'm referring to the phenomenological experience, and in particular way at the logic research of Edmund Husserl. I mean, this pen is a pen, but it's also a sign of everything that constitute this pen and are making an object of my experience. Carlosini recently, talking about Husserl, underline how the index is a constitution of sense, the being sign of a process constantly in becoming, in its modes of givenness. The experimental gaze, will say Husserl, but how you do that? Husserl quote Goethe, in principle was the action. Action. Reanimates action, the constitutive action that the painting retains in itself, in a dimension which is retentive and protentive. We bring to light the action, the practice of life, the knowledge. So that means the world in his mode of givenness, in his gegebenheit. This is what occupies the model and this translation into parameter. But we're gonna come back later on this point. Right now, let's leave it on the background to recover after what we have introduced, the important point. Action, act, intuition. We say that we can image. The imagination as a means to attend the image in its apprehension, through the suspension of every obstacle, every judge. The epoche to come back at that intuition that it became form. Il starting to approach the important word of painting one. Presence, body, experience. Important word of the phenomenological experience. We should not be afraid to interpret it starting from the sign, even if always we're gonna be confronted with a void. With a void. There is a difference between semiotic and hermeneutic. There is a void, with a very productive one. All the knowledge is developed from that. Benjamin was talking about this void. Says the title of this meeting, aware or unaware of this legacy, the artist becomes dispersed in the painting and in its phenomenological cognitive experience, which, as possibly is not other discipline, become a fundamental experience. So painting one starts from the different technique to determine the experience of the artist, to set up his legacy in relation with a different proposal on which is possible to terminate a reflection that bring us to that vaporization and centralization of the high, defined perfectly by Baudelaire in his intimate diary. This capacity to determinate an apprehension of the world through act. Act that as act are always intentional. And this because consciousness is always consciousness of something. So also the non-intentional act are based on intentionality. At that proposal, it's interesting the thesis of another philosopher, Meinong, but like Husserl, show how the intentionality is to move beyond a transcendental act towards the object. In the sense that the consciousness, being consciousness of an object, overtakes its own substance to let the object appear. The object for Meinong are the empirical fact, but also the ideal essence, like the mathematical and the imaginary one. To sum up, we can say that the entire semiotic system of the language precipitates into the semantic of enunciation, so brilliantly described by Louis Maren as the, quote, the analysis by the present of the present to itself of the speaking ego. End quote. Louis Maren points out how, quote, to represent means to present oneself representing something. And every representational sign or process includes two dimensions, a reflexive dimension, presenting oneself, and a transitive dimension, representing something, with a twofold effect, the effect of the subject and that of the object. According to the principle of resemblance, the mimetic act of representation acts in two different ways. The principle presupposes the replacement of the present element with a model of an absent element. In nature, mimicry is the ability to deceive in order to gain an evolutionary advantage. In ostentatious Bartesian mimicry, one species attempt to imitate another in order to dissuade predator. The animal conforms to the absent model by taking on its form. Here there is a desubjectifying vaporization in which forms are adopted but are not their own, but similar through chromatic aposematism. The loss of oneself in the other and in nature take place through self-denial. We can call this type of relationship ostentation mimicry. The act of hiding from a predator by confusing oneself chromatically against one's background is referred to by biologists as cryptic mimicry. The locust does not deny itself, but confuses itself with the nature around it. What takes place is a subjectifying centralization that entails assumption of form, color and behave that makes the individual similar to its environment or to some part of it. Confusing oneself in nature without negating oneself through deception is a form of crypticism. Unlike the Lepidopteran that show itself as a leaf, The cicada remains what it is. In cryptic mimicry, the mimicry is indirect, and there is a form in which one can be cryptic by hiding. So there is a narrator who adjusts the composition. We can talk of cryptic or diegetic mimicry. To sum up, we can say that the ostentatious mimicry is desubjectifying and direct, while cryptic mimicry is subjectifying and indirect. In the relationship between subject and object, through the medium and its specificity, the work constitutes an account of the artist's author's inner movement of centralizing and vaporizing action. A controlled objectivation of the subject through a subjectifying scatological dimension that leads to the action is centralizing. An objectivation controlled by the object in a desubjectifying relationship to the author is vaporizing. In this context, it is interesting to point out how the etymon of the word scatology is excrement and material, but also reasoning. In this sense, if we take a close look at Mondrian, we can see the residuality of his brush stroke, closing with a powerful, objectifying, compositional guidance of grid, which are decided in advance. The action is what remains of the subject, a precious residue of its weakness and uniqueness. It is the objectifying urge of the subject that pushes to emerge in a vital impulse that immediately recalls its opposite, the inorganic death of its residuality, and an attempt to objectify itself as a residual subjectifying and centralizing presence. The residuality recalls death, a call to return to the origin, and a crypticism which is that of the insect which, in order not to be captured, cryptically blends into nature and compresses itself into the limit imposed upon it by its background. The same crypticism can also be found in Mondrian's Black Witch, even though it remains in the objectivity of the grid, show itself in its direction. As we have seen, the controlled objectivation of the object is vaporizing. Mondrian's black line is objectivized as a miserable, repeatable line, which is evident in its representation. The subject identifies with the represented object in an analytical manner, denying itself as evidence of the other. An example of this is a butterfly, which, with its particular color, mimics the leaf in order to hide from the predator. This coming out of oneself to support the other is an expression of erotic seduction, for, unlike the locust, which hide cryptically, the butterfly shows itself for what it is not, in other words, a leaf. In this case, the subject does not amplify itself, but rather negate itself in an active mimicry, in the object represented, and, in the case of Mondrian, in the composition. The use of the technique and its own internal quality is subjectifying term, is centralizing, while the use of the technique and its qualities in the subjectifying terms is vaporizing. We are saying that materia, color, became a place of refiguration, a support. Materia, color, is duplicating, creating an image of the world. The invention of writing is a threshold of the man. Through sign, the thing is articulate, is divided, is dematerialized, in order to become the analogon of the things, a place of refiguration. The sign, figure in itself, and figure as a something else. The world became an image. The orbis became pictus. I invite the public to dip in the chapter regarding the technique. The chapter presents a series of binomials in which take place the oscillation and the operativity of the artist at work. And I would like to proceed in the conversation, arguing that the different points that we're gonna touch are constituting a structure, a topology. But let's proceed for small step, passing from what it seems to us innegable. That means that the painting gonna refigurate something, and so we're gonna talk about a genre, that they're gonna occupy a space, and so a dimension, a format, but they're gonna be in a place, and so we're gonna talk about exposition. In other words, that a series of factors are defining the determination of that decoupling of the world, but Wittgenstein had defined place of refiguration. And this is starting from us, from what is closest to us, from our being men, and as a man inserted inside a context, a social context. We are in Occident, and our qualities determinate on the base of a series of practices of life that succeeded and from which we should start, we should move. And in this dimension is developed the chapter regarding the model. The return of the world, the practice that determines in its present form, is a reflection on the language, on the render that clarifies the word evoked by the sign, and in its return constitute an atlas. The reference is to Abi Warburg and to the Atlas Mnemosyne, but it wanna be in a certain way a theory on the sign, a theory on the pathos formal. The sign, it became interpreted. The research is coming back, is return. And talking about living and going, immediately came out in our mind the oscillation that the sign, in its being meaningful, exhibit. The reference is to Derrida, and to the necessity of an extension of the research of the problem of the difference as an oscillation not anymore internal to the dialectic signifier into the restriction of the de saussure linguistic, but opened to the practice of life as an interpreter of the frisol determined by the language and by its context of use. And here the reflection doesn't bring only to the second Wittgenstein, but also to the research, to the recent research of developed by the Italian philosopher Carlo Sini, on the line of Ivan Illich, on the line of the text man of Peirce, von Humboldt. So the practice of life, the work of the man, the knowledge. The model can be defined as a vet part of historical world, but today sees definition in the division of knowledge, in the different specialization that are characterizing the consciousness, our being man. And what are these practices? Heidegger resumes the history of man as like his capacity of produce the absence, tito on. That means the principle and the cause. The cause that produces the essence in his representability. And it's clear here is reference to Aristotle. Modern age brings to his radicality the capacity, Heidegger say, to define the essence as itself, in his becoming, in his living and his permaining. And what it is how it is, as an object of knowledge, manipulation, and elaboration, who is given us as a specialization, as a principle. If the assumption of a model is a positiveness that the artist used to determine his operativity, let's take a classic example of Cézanne and his obsession for geometry and optic, that are working as a model. The parameter is a translation, the formal translation of the model, and in the case of Cézanne, the reduction of all the volume of the painting into the logic of the sphere, the conus, and the cylinder, placed in a certain perspective. Going to the deepness of the problem, in order that you don't believe that the model is only occupied in illustrate a knowledge without any transcendence, but we are talking about a copy image, app build, without making her subjectively objective, Let's try to understand how Heidegger writes that quote, what is in work, in the work is Eröffnung, the openship of the essence to the being, the making event of the truth, das Geschäftnis der Wahrheit. The pregnancy of the problem could be developed with a good example. Starting from one of the first mythical figures elaborated by the archaic man, the nympha, and here I'm thinking to Ghirlandaio. The model of Ghirlandaio was the myth, and is a myth referring a propose of the nympha and his characteristic. Abbe Warburg remembered in his writing about the deep disorientation that the nympha of Ghirlandaio was provoking in him. And the myth is referring a propose of disorientation produced by the nympha. The nymph of Ghirlandaio created disorientation, disoriented his public, but other nymphs, for example, of the tradition are not able to do that, doesn't have that power. They are only illustrating the disorientation. And so the question is, what is a disorientation? In what consists? Through which knowledge, which writing of word are coming back in the Ghirlandaio? George D.D. Huberman, in his beautiful book on Abbe Warburg, superior to the Gombrich one under several aspects, is talking about the nature of the disorientation, recalling the question of dialectic element, of internal opposition of the image, from Judith and Holofernes, passing from the classic calm, element taken from the mythology as a model and translated in formal parameter, sign on which inscribe the image. We see so that the model and the parameter define the style and are giving a positivity at all the other elements of the structure. There is a beautiful phrase of Italo Calvino who say every city receives a form from the desert who is opposing to her. In Le Città Invisibili. In the way it acts as an element within the language of painting, painting practice can be considered as a semantic network and as a structure that is crystallized through a series of relationships between the various structures it stems from. The medium has a series of characteristics and nodes that enter into relationship with the genre, with the format, with the model and its translation into a parameter, and with the display, in a structuring based on the topological principle of union, compactness, and continuity. The decision, the norm that lies at the heart of the connection that bring about connectivity, is in the relationship between the part, and it defines the morphology of the work. The intuition precedes the linguistic content. It is identified in painting one as a punct. I later discovered that Ernst Cassirer was talking the same term, defining how from the desire and the will was developed the linguistic signification and the definition of the discourse structure. Painting practice marked the introduction of normed space into art on the premises of a linguistic decision that placed connectivities as a constituent part of the space work. To give an example, Cubism introduced the norm, the Cubist program, that brought about precise formal option. It is no coincidence that in between Einstein and Picasso, Mario Shapiro note how, in 1914, George Riemann was, together with other mathematicians, included in the catalogue of an exhibition of Cubist work in Prague, Budapest and Moscow, as one of the creators of non-Euclidean geometry. In topology, Minkowski space, which is named after the famous mathematician, is a space-time model that defines the existence of a norm but regulates the construction of space. Shapiro later used it to introduce the concept of time into Cubism concern. The decision of Cubist painter to use neutral color in the analytical phase, as well a particular type of painting material, can be viewed as a way of applying a cognitive model to the painting based on a precise hematology, the Cubist style. Analyzing the painting The Poet of 1911, here we see an example of full mesh topology, in which each element of the system is linked to the other. A file created on a computer is replicated directly in all the other. The optic time and structure, which form the model of Cubist space, are transferred to a parameter that is formalized as a subjective and analytical deconstruction of the object portrayed. This figure forms part of the portrait genre, and in terms of its emotive neutrality, it is painted in a borderline format between the mental and the neutral, just as the color chosen are oil, which is a quintessential analytic medium. The canonical display emphasizes the invitation to the viewer to venture into a form of contemplation that requires sight alone. The synthetic Cubist period started in 1911, when the object was first analyzed and then deconstructed before being synthetically reassembled to investigate its essence. In this period, the Cubist had a preference for painting still life with fluid, violins, bottle, glasses, and newspaper flattened onto the surface of the painting. They also returned to the chromatic richness which had been lacking in the analytical period. The composition of those years often include elements from the real world, such as letters, numbers, piece of paper, and newspaper cutting. Here, the Cubism had a program for analyzing the motif from the experience of the observer, mediated by time, which made a norm of pictorial space. And this led to a shift of time, first adopted as a model and then transferred by destructuring the object observed from various points of view. This is a parameter by which the space of pictorial vision is formalized. In the first analytical stage of Cubism, oil was chosen for its notable flexibility and for its many semantic nodes. The choice of neutral tones, such as brown, gray, and ochre, respond to a wish to reduce the emotive scope of the vision in favor of a focus on the structure, which was built up through the arbitrary nature of the artist. Classical theory of vision and Merleau-Ponty's phenomenology agree on the fact that the third dimension is invisible, since it is nothing other than our own vision. In the later synthetic period, the decision to replace oil with charcoal, gouache, and ink was brought about by a Cubist style that formed its objective in the distinctive nature of the medium. Picasso's intention was to use collage in Cubist space, introducing it as a fragment of reality that ascended to the level of painting. To bring about this perspective shift of the semantic and optical nature of the foreign body, Picasso had to create a semantic structure that would bring the fragment of reality into categories that, in the act of observation, define the field of painting. To create this network, the various elements had to have a relationship of continuity, compactness, and union, thus creating not only the illusion, but also a redefinition within the composition of the characteristic which make painting recognizable for what it is. In order to be perceived as a painting, papier collé has to be blended in, submitting to the rule of representation in order to lose its trace, so that it cannot be recognized as a real. In order to introduce papier collé as a representation, Picasso had to resort to a cryptic form of mimesis, which called for the loss of self in nature, but without self-negation. The real element remains what is interpreted in painting terms. A newspaper is still a newspaper in the composition. In the chapter of media, we can see that in terms of connectivity, the synthetic qualities of watercolor and, by extension, of gouache make them more suitable for a cryptic form of mimesis, while oil help create ostentatious mimicry. The cryptic or diegetic mimicry promoted by the use of gouache, graphite and ink enable collage to develop as a key element in synthetic cubism. In Rosalind Krauss' view, the introduction of the semantic element further highlights the value of the signifier as the form at the base of collage. This possibility is not brought into play in ready-made, but through the introduction of papier-collé as a painting, with the formal relationship that work on signified and replace them with signifier. It is a cryptic mimicry that makes it possible to create a relationship between papier-collé and the language of painting. Painting One, in the last chapter, defines the suspension of judge, the epoché, as a way to swim upstream from the topological structure to the intuition of the work through the flux of life, Leibniz-Strom. Mathematically, that thing has been demonstrated by Grigori Perelman, Russian mathematician, that he solved the conjecture of Poincaré, demonstrating how all the topological space are referable to the torus, or in the perfect case to the sphere, starting from the develop of the point, the punct. From the punct to the sphere to the punct. Like say, from the intuition to the work to the retrieve of the intuition. If you talk about the formation of the formation of language is not an arbitrary nomination at the subject will, but it's signed that when it's been posed, it's unraisable. So we should figure out a word that was approaching the man, and this encountering was causing, was determining a phonic reaction, but was nominating, but was bringing into the formation of the concept. Cassirer, Ernst Cassirer, on the line of Usener, Gotten Name, fantastic book, define how the concept is delimited inside the border of his expression and there permeates in his variation. The work approaching us, it provocates certain neuronal reaction. We should think about the mirror neuron. It's bringing sign that belong in their manifestation at that mythical formation, but perpetually return towards a viewer that is able to receive it. In this perpetually return, it's originary, take shape of the artist's bodily act which become a sign by the capacity of the material to determine a legacy, to articulate sensation, stopping the sensation into the painting surface. The permanence, but we are not happy to think about that because we consider everything as nothing, but everything going to disappear. It's a Tommaso, at least in the Christian tradition, say that creation is, Tommaso say, creatio ex nihilo sui, from nothing. But if these things it seems strange, it's again the language to clarify the value of the content of the image. In a recent study, the Polish theologist Pirzivara, in his book Analogia Entis, develop how the word image, but in German is Bild, is constructed on the roots Bild, that means miraculous force, extraordinary force. Bild means initially prodigious sign. The declination are Biliben, means give essence, and Bilibon, means copy a figure but is working as a model. This essence is inside the capacity of the work to indicate the eternal time of the myth, the archetypus. You can say, well, okay, but who knows this archetypus? But Don't have to worry about that because they are acting on us through the language continuously. Sometimes we can recognize them or smell them, sometimes no. So basically we should interrogate on our capacity to be alive in front of a piece before talking about his death. For the last part of this talk, I will focus on the pictorial genre. Painting One analyzes the classic pictorial genre, starting from the relation with the author. In this sense, not mentioning now history painting, still life, or portraits, but posing with a quickly consideration on the abstract art, we see how the discourse, how this argument is developed starting from the idea of detachment, abtraere, for which comes the word abstract, abtraere, detachment from the subject in a depotentialization that sees radicality into the expression of different and consequential and elegant way of this the possibility of the author to negate or problematize his position of I. Abandoning this, I think, interesting highlight, I would like to introduce an argument that in Painting One is already announced, and that in a not exhausting way has been touched in a second text that I presented as a work at the Bergen Kunsthalle last year, The Horizon After Commodity, Note on Perversion. The thematic is fascinating. What is at stake is important because it takes into consideration as a hypothesis of work, and so as a capability to be developed, the possibility of painting to develop new modes of collaboration, to step out the safe relationship represented by narration, or the solipsistic dimension of authoriality, engaging the author into the determination of a discourse. The discourse, Benveniste, remember us, is talking not only about I, but also about you, us, and this became us, so he's introducing the presence of a life relationship. The theme is the show, the exhibition, and we know that exhibition means different piece, that means dialogue. So I will talk about this exhibition painting. And to give a base on it, I will say that an art exhibition is first and foremost a mental vision, a concept that links the work together and folk them attempt to give a meaningful structure to the world. It is therefore the visual content of an insight that the artist conveys through the medium of painting, among other means, and his capacity to translate folk. Working from this observation, I suggest extending the range of painterly genre to include curatorial practice, translating the content of the exhibition into the code of painting, into an exhibition painting, a show that operates within the framework of representation. Like any exhibition, it includes works by various artists, but by focusing on the concept, it fruitfully sets itself apart from various artistic experiments in appropriation and reappropriation art. The freedom of expression offered by the mediation of painting is what unschlägt the exhibition and its concept from several limitations. So that it can reconstruct itself within the sphere of the canvas as a realm of imagination and emancipation. As a proposition that the viewer's mind is invited to take, bringing the experience of the show to completion on its own. Through images, the exhibition painting would seem to take Lorenz Wiener's ideas about the role of the viewer to a radical extreme, combining them with the cognitive exploration of Abby Warburg's Atlas, and further complicating the unstable relationship that exists between language and its context, between nature and culture, between similarity and simile. All men, by nature, desire to know. An indication of this is the delight that we take in our sense. This is Aristotle saying. For even apart from their usefulness, they are loved for themselves, and above all other, the sense of sight. For not only with a view to action, but even when we are not going to do anything, we prefer seeing, one might say, to everything else. The reason is that this, most of all the senses, makes us know and brings to light many differences between things. End quote. Another quotation from Vittorio Gallese, an Italian scientist who discovered the mirror neuron. The observation of an object leads to deployment of the motorial program we activate when we wish to interact with this same object. This means that seeing an object signifies automatically evoking what we will do with that object. It means simulating a potential action. Our neurons are discharged when the action is accomplished, observed, listened to, and imagined. End quote. If, for the sake of argument, we had an infinite number of images of an exhibition, we would have the entire show. Because, as the Italian geneticist Edoardo Boncinelli has pointed out, quote, the brain has a spatializing vision, in which the sense of movement is our primary perception, on the same level as color, form, and light and shade. We do not have time other than as a cultural construct. The only perception of time is that of spatialization. End quote. The discovery of a mirror neuron has shown that the premotor area are activated by what one sees. This means that the individual image of this potentially infinite group of images is part of our experience of the exhibition, for in it we find the necessary precondition for its potentially infinite new proposal as potency. On an uninterrupted linear development of the exhibition experience as an emotional and cognitive event in our brain. At the theoretical level, it is possible to conceptualize the exhibition as a potential infinity of point of view and images of a linear structure in development of the exhibition as a whole. This means that if we accept but for this necessary relationship between the images to come about, we can define and focus on some of them. It is as folks we were talking photograph, and these selected images will thus form part of our experience of the exhibition. Individual pictures are therefore images that evoke the entirety of the exhibition, since they are taken from that whole. The image retains in itself the sense of the exhibition by focusing on one view as a significant element of the totality evoked. The signifier is the sense of the exhibition as a configuration of a space in which the works relate to themselves in a certain way, as they do to what is outside of them. In relation to themselves, they appear within the space with their respective semantic complexities, and outside of themselves, within their external context, they reveal their appearance under a certain opinion, under a certain doxa, who means I show myself, but structure the encounter, convergence, and manifestation, in which doxa also indicate glory as the height of visibility. The decision, the norm, has defined a system in which, through their characteristic, the works give shape to a sense, a direction, and a form of positiveness. The definition of a normal topological space is a configuration evoked by the sign of the work themselves that the norm brings to light in the exhibition, the sense of which could not exist without the indication of the work themselves. The semantic but underpin the potential for collecting, bringing together, and defining an organism, and thus not just mere accumulation, give form to a complex meaning that starts out from the apparition of memory, from Atlas as mnemosyne. This is a materialization of memory in the mind that primarily within reflection organizes a conceptual space in the exhibition place, which, as we have seen, is arranged for study and contemplation under the auspices of the muses, identifying the place of study from studio with the museum. I will introduce you to the exhibition painting Das Fest, an exhibition painting recently created for Hypothesis for an exhibition, a show that I had at PSM, Gallery in Berlin, curated by Lorenzo Benedetti. To introduce you a bit how it happened, is that Lorenzo decided to invite seven artists. These seven artists was me, Katinka Bock, David Adamo, Osten Hassan, Batia Suter, Olaf Nikolai, and Dario De Rocco. And now invite us for a group exhibition. I didn't know which kind of work that this artist was bringing to the show, but I decided to, starting from the same artist, create another exhibition. In order that when he was entering in the space, he was confronted with these two possible visions, these two possible evocations of the world. And I decided to call my exhibition Das Fest. Of course, when you was entering the exhibition, you had a double press release. That was mine and Lorenzo one. I can show you also some picture of the installation later, because I'm in a PDF. But to focus about the content of Das Fest, I'd like to say is an observation of how, in the work of artists like David Adamo, such as his sculpture untitled Column 7 of 2011, we find a loss of the function of work as a value, as a promised by the surrealist aesthetic of counterproduction, with a new social sense of the constructivist object that become a fetish in an ecstatic sense. In Untitled Column 7, the figure of the worker, implicit in poiesis as a production, is that of pointless, antifunctional work, for it puts an end to the constructive utility of the piece of wood. It is on this meaningful aspect of Adamo's work that in Das Fest is placed as a totem. Around the totem pole there is chanting, another necessary element in archaic festivities, with Olaf Nikolai celebrates with Innere Stimme, a work of 2010, a work in which voice take up a piece that Schumann considered could not be sung. Recovery of the discourse take place through offering the public the chant in the rooms. By combining the voice that spread out through the space in a single melody, the audience can only imagine the power of the romantic composition through the detail. It was in archaic festivity that discordant shout reached the climax in sharing the rhythm. Again, in Das Fest, Dario De Rocco, offer an industrial glove and confer magical content upon it for the title, We Shall Never Touch the Dark, 2010. Which in the power of the gesture, rising up from the ground, makes reference to a remote ritual action. This evocation of the work is augmented by the sacrificial aspect that we shall never touch the dark acquired in the complex system that Das Fest aimed to circumscribe. Adopting the perspective of work as a loss of value, we found Katinka Bock's form on Inhalt, in which the fragility of the sculpture refers to the natural cycle of transformation and decay. In Das Fest, this sense of natural materiality is underscored and reinforced by the background created by Batia Suter, untitled Wall and Column, of 2006, A poster forming part of an atlas which contextualizes things within its own totalizing meaning. In this fest, it recalls a natural place of memory, reconstructed in the form of a large black and white prints, which form the background, the backdrop to the festive place, bordered by the fire of condensed castle wall, one of my work of 2009. Ostein Hassan, on other hand, is a producer of archive and documentation, libraries and of indecipherable books, meticulously constructed to create multiple point of view. Like the plinth sculpture display unit, Black Mirror of 2009. At the entrance of the exhibition space in Berlin, this raised visitors to a panoramic level so that they could see the entire space. The original work of Ostein was a different shape. And so in order to set up for my exhibition, I entered in dialogue with Ostein and we decided to get the shape for this work. Because it consists, this work for him is a site-specific installation, so all the time can change. It's interesting how, for me, in order to be able to draw his work, I had to enter in dialogue with him. I think it's a productive point of view. In Das Fest, the obscurity of the plinth is a place of festive contemplation, to which the word theory, in its Indo-European roots, originally referred. Within, if we can think of decline as a radicalization of festive project of capitalism, undermining it from within in the cultural space of the private study, while waiting for a new renaissance to come about as a power raised to the highest power. At that point, there will be no longer, be division or struggle. Everything will celebrate the joyous festivity of hypothetical truths. Thank you.
So I think it will make sense now that I bring more light to the space.
Yes, light.
And that we emit.
Yeah, we can talk about. Yes.
And so also focusing maybe a little bit on how they could function as a discursive practice, maybe.
Yeah. I understand your question concerning the visual practice because, of course, in the moment in which, for example, I'm referring to work who are produced before the exhibition, it somehow became limited this dialogue, but. It's also something I'm developing in this period, and I'm discovering because I'm trying to understand how potentialize this possibility, and in order to define this dimension of dialogue, and as a painting as a new mode of collaboration, I'm for example working with Mr. Andreas Schlegel, who is with us, to an exhibition together. Where, for example, this in this case, the content of the image, it will be the result of an idea and of a dialogue that we're gonna engage. We are discussing. So painting is not anymore only that dimension in which on which basically has been developed in the last 100 years as a affirmation or negation of the I. But it can open up to be a platform of discussion of rule to enter finally in a dialogue with also different perspective that contemporary art is offering to us. But of course, the possibility of doing that right now is theoretically because we are approaching this possibility, and I will let you know what's happened in the sense that it's a research, you know, something to discover. Talking about this work, it's one work, is titled San Gerolamo, and you can recognize a place with the German Pavilion in Venice, some of you maybe recognize the work of Lyon Gillick. Some of you recognize maybe other work. But what was interesting for me is that the system defined by the different work in their contextualization open up to different level of interpretation. Let's say the first one, it could be the one related to the language of art. And so we can recognize a series of artists that in a different way are related or receive a certain heritage from institutional critique, in which, of course, the main point was problematize the context in which art was developing, was problematize the relation with the institution and the possibility of art to define a freedom. Under this idea of problematization respect the context of power with approaching the work, the same work are reconstructing the symbolic premises of a painting of Antonello da Messina, San Gerolamo nello studio, with a painting that Antonello paint in order to problematize the relationship of this guy who is Sisto IV, who was at the beginning a Franciscan, as you can see from his shoes, what placed here, but as soon he became in power, he started to somehow cheat all the important premises of the church. And so what Antonello did is somehow create a dimension in which apparently the figure of San Gerolamo is celebrate, but only apparently, because there are a series of elements who define a negative reading, a negative interpretation of this painting. And these different negative elements are, in different terms, coming back, evoked by that series of words. We are happy to think about, for example, the lion as a close to San Gerolamo, because San Gerolamo helped the lion removing a stick of wood from his leg. And of course, in certain positive critique, it be written that the lion was somehow happy and hanging around in this kind of gymnasium. But if exists this premises, but at the same time, the sign open up, we were talking about this void, open up to certain different interpretation. And now with this light, you have to trust me, the lion has, for example, his arm is up, and the face of the lion is pretty sad. Actually, this impostor didn't help the lion. And the lion so is remaining on the shadow, far from San Gerolamo. He's on the shadow and the floor is shining here. It's shining. Well, here, right now with this projection we can really see. Well, here the shadow, the floor is more, is not reflecting. And this is a symbolic dimension in Antonello painting, because it talks about the purity and impurity. There are different symbols of impurity, but that's coming back in the painting. But talking about the lion is a symbol of Venice. In the Testamento, the paper you write when you die, of Antonello, a series of reference respect to Venice, and that's the reason also because I started to focus on the possibility to display this exhibition inside the German Pavilion. Not only for the lion, of course. As you know, in the German pavilion, Ansack showed many years ago, in the main room, he wrote Germania, and the floor was destroyed. No, he destroyed the floor of the main room, leaving not destroyed the floor in the other room. And what happened is that, of course, after reconstructing the floor, the new floor is more shining than the floor in the side. Exactly how it happened in this painting. As you can see, for example, the lion is a work of Piero Golia. It's made with magnet. And so it's very dangerous for people because, first of all, steal your money. Second of all, if you're a pacemaker or stuff like that, it can be dangerous approaching. So is a lion remain in the shadow, in this shining floor, with the floor of the main room, but it's shining because reconstructed by after the work of Hacke. Again, we see, for example, here, Hacke come back reconstructing this detail. This detail is a dirty towel, of course, symbol of impurity, because a towel should be clean, white, you know? But it's not. And immediately you can think about this piece of Hacke with this flag, with the plante, but he showed that Paula Cooper in 2004, if I remember well. But of course, his use of the American flag is made in order to problematize the American identity and the question of capitalism and so on. As you can see, there is a plant, the cats, like in Gimmick piece. But it's interesting again, these two shoes, they seem just throw it back, but actually they are constructing the Tau Kreuz, who is the Franciscan one, who is helping us to identify Sisto Quarta as an impostor. And under this question of shoes who make us belong or not belong to something, it's interesting how the work of Josh Green, that it's here, is a letter that he wrote to Miuccia Prada, asking her to send, say, I'm an artist, you know, I'm not really successful right now, probably because I miss your Prada shoes. So in order to be accepted by a certain circle, I need to be equipped by this kind of shoes. And Miuccia Prada never replied to him. It's interesting that they try again to write to her using the paper of Hammer Museum in LA, but even that nothing happened. So a question of belong or not belong to something, it reconstructed this two point of the painting of San Gerolamo. Again, we say that there are negative symbols. It seems that Sisto Quarto was a very erotic and somehow complex person, not really a pure saint like San Gerolamo should be. And it's interesting how it seems also that in the book is reading there are certain interpretation, and there are the unwritten erotic story of Simon Fujiwara, who are standing in front of this sculpture of Giacomo Manzù. Again, about this kind of dimension, sexual dimension, purity, impurity. You see, but in order to enter inside this scene, we have three symbols here. These three symbols are the vernice, the peacock, and this plate. It's interesting, but of course, three negative symbol, who are introducing art into the reading of that painting. And here you can see how the Pernice, in a Picasso way, is played by Manfred Pernice, but it's not only that, I will arrive to another point, it's pretty interesting from my point of view. Here's the peacock, who is Sylph Lawyer, probably whom I saw this beautiful this chair, a pencil, and so you have really this dispersion of this chromatical dispersion of different color, remind me the peacock. This broken plate reconstructed by Goran Petterkoll.
Is this a performance?
No,
I don't really understand.
No, no, it's well, I don't.
But you can watch for 3 hours on.
No, I can stop at a certain point. I can stop at a certain point. Is
was just curious.
Yeah. No, soon also because I'm tired. So, but just let me finish a couple of points. It's interesting how the title of the work are only titled After Reflection, Foundation. And that means, you know, only after a reflection you can get a foundation, otherwise it remains without title, so you don't have somehow a direction in reading the piece. This is a pretty interesting point. I never understood why, but I like to live here in a kind of suspended dimension. It's part of a show of Trisha Donnelly at Porticus, and she is really precise. I admire a lot of her work. And if you go to see the work in the website, you discover that everything is with correct quotation and description, except this red stripe, but it was cutting particles in the middle, who is totally without any description, and so you don't understand if it's a work, if it's not a work. Everything is detailed, described, except this particular. And so I decide to place as this inside this inside the first painting, in first and the second painting, because I like this dimension with the identity of this sign was not really clarified. Yeah, so we have this second reading, say, is one of the reconstruction of this San Gerolamo. I can go on, but I don't wanna stress you with other point. You can also figure out by yourself. Carlos Garaycoa, the book. And the third, somehow, possibility, but is a kind of accidental one, is the fact that they reconstruct a kind of domestic ambient. So starting from really the shape of the work, I mean, a children's first things you can probably might see or might recognize is this dimension, this kind of homey dimension, you know, this domestic dimension with books, eggs, kitchen, the unsacred one, animal, cats, yes. I titled this piece San Gerolamo, and yes, it's one of the last work I developed. Other question?
So this is an illustration for your theory.
It's not really an illustration for my theory, because I may say that I don't know if you listened before or not.
Yeah.
Okay, so I tried, for me the interesting point was I tried to also leave something of me in this painting. Of course it's my theory, it's my vision, it's my research, but in this act of painting, we leave, as I say, some trace, no? We're talking about ourselves. And so the point is try to translate the content of the exhibition, starting from the idea that is first and foremost an intuition, an image that we have in the mind, and try to determine this possibility inside in the translation side of the code, respect the reality one. This doesn't want to enter necessarily in competition, but it's just encouraging to develop the content of the exhibition also in different terms. I take you an example. I made for the exhibition Das Fest, for example, we started as I say with this inside this discussion with Lorenzo Benedetti. After a curator in Wroclaw, Marianne Tomichnik, decided to create another version, possible dimension of Das Fest. She's a real curator and she made a real exhibition. But starting from some hypotheses, some premises that I determinate in my painting, in this one, she shows different artists and totally different content, but somehow from that background, everything started. And one of the future possible ideas is also merge these two exhibitions together in order to define this exhibition painting also in productive terms. So it doesn't exclude the possibility to produce the exhibition after. But if you talk about if it's my theory, well, yes, but at the same time, as I say, and my English is not so special, so I can also come back on the phrase. I can only, let me find, because I want to be precise. Okay, no, I don't found this minute. Okay, by the way, I can enter in relationship work starting from the signed, creating new contextualization, but first of all, I try all the time to understand, being an artist, you know, I don't like if someone takes something I did and totally subverts, you know. So I pay really a lot of attention in understanding how the work has been documented and so in understand how the artist authorized the display of his piece. And I stay inside, most possible, inside this rule. Of course, the display, it can be constructed in different terms. For example, Aristotle in the Metaphysics says that the disposition can be made in regards of the form, the place, and the potential. And so if you say that the Goran Petrikov liked his plate on the floor, well, we can discuss about that, but I develop a potential of a plate who is broken. You know, normally plate doesn't fly. And I like this gravity that somehow take it into the floor. And this means that it's somehow the interpretation is developed from certain quality that the work may have inside itself. Yes.
But you could do photo collage as well.
The point of not doing photo collage is exactly the question that we define about the mirror neuron. Because if I have certain sensation, you know, in front of something, we say, we understood by science, so for once let's believe a bit on her, but our mirror, maybe I should explain a bit more what mirror neurons are. Has been discovered like that. Was this monkey eating peanuts? And he had all the machine to take the measure of the work of the brain of that monkey. And you know, the scientist was observing the neuronal reaction of the monkey eating the peanuts. After 2 weeks, a certain point, a scientist entered, he didn't know about what this colleague was doing, and he just take a peanut and eat it. And all of a sudden, the neuron of the monkey, this chair, like if she was acting. And this was a very interesting point, because make after with a series of research discover that our neurons are reacting not only when we act, but also when we see something. And so this question of seeing something, it means that there is not all the image have the same quality, but a painted image has a different quality respect to a not painted one. there is some legacy, but some sensation that I proved, I felt, thinking about this piece, but aware and unaware, I abandoned. And in that terms, the photo collage could not give back all this series of sensation are the most closer to my original idea and my original intuition. You have to think a lot about this question of the gesture, because even before the language, the way in which the archaic man was reacting was from moving. The first expression was from movement, before even the phonic explanation. There is a direct determination of our thought from the gesture, but it can be productively developed to the painting. It's like to say, when you, for example, go to the police, they ask you to, for example, to write stuff, because from the calligraphy they can define certain characteristics of your persona, but you might hide, but you are not able to hide. But you go signature, no? You understand that it's not the same if your signature is written on the computer. It will be always your name, but it will be just this abstract, detached dimension, and not all this series of breathing, living, all this practice of life who are co-extensively producing your firma. And so, let's say, I understand your point of view, but I think abandon the possibility of display our idea for ourselves, it would be a pity.
So it's a display of your idea?
Yes, but, not of someone else, or in certain case it could be also of other person who can ideate the exhibition with me, and so it will be our idea. Yes, yes, but I mean, as an artist, I'm dealing in a certain way with, in any case, also myself, no?
Thank you for asking my question concerning the
collage. But you paint from photos, or in the exhibition?
No, this exhibition never existed. Yeah, unfortunately, I mean, I paint from, I am a book collector, I love book, I love, really, you know, so I have a bunch of, and so I paint using the documentation that the artist allowed, in their website, in their exhibition. You can recognize pretty clearly a certain point of view of Lion Gillick exhibition, but was in this case the starting point, is the starting inspiration. In another painting, I just have to see that is different, because you can't recognize the space because it doesn't exist. So all these points are in process of being developed. You see also, for example, this painting. Now you don't understand, but it's even smaller than that. It's the middle. It's like that. A really small, a really mental space. And the painting is more like drawn. It's more, to solve a certain piece, I just really use a few signs, trying to give just the impression. Where this, what I made after, I try to analyze the form more in detail. And, well, if I'm gonna make the exhibition, I will be happy. But again, I don't agree with you in the term that one denies the invitation to the other. You know, these are way. If the exhibition, and we can talk in case about that, is a content, an intuition, an image that you get in your mind, After you can do about this content is on your responsibility. If you are, for example, a writer, there are writers who write, no, text, and this, and so you, why don't say it's like, wow, you don't need your writing, you know, but it's just exhibition. It's the same. It's a different modality to display the content of the mind.
What about the form?
Yes, I have another question. Yeah. So my question would be. So we have some of the artists, and you also like Liam Gillick, and you also talked about Hans Hake, which we know also as artists not paying, as far as I can see, normally not, but they are well known for what they are practicing as institutional practice, and normally you can't find paintings which could be related to the discussions of institutional critique.
Yes, right. But I'm
reflecting.
Yes. On the question of institutional critique, it was interesting inside this system as a reference also to the question of problematization, but also Antonello was defining in his painting. But what I'm trying to underline with my work is, of course, an heritage of that institutional critique in the moment in which, as an artist, I'm confronted with certain of the problem and the precious point that this artist developed. But at the same time, I don't believe that this is what it can define today's a gesture of freedom. And talking about this question of freedom, I think the most the way in which the freedom has been defined, I'm referring to the cultural industry of Adorno and Horkheimer, who is also one of the main texts on which this generation has somehow deep in develop content. Adorno Horkheimer say, well, the freedom from the romanticism and go after the expressionism and so on has always been defined as a gesture, as a singularity, who was somehow determining this Dionysian dimension, who was being unsubordinated because it was in opposition to certain fixed greed. This we can say about the color field against the composition, the destruction of the harmony in music, the psychological penetration against the structure of the novel. But the question is, in a society of spectacle, in a cultural industry that determines itself as an industry of effect, as a production of image who are determined all the time under this dimension of the singularity and the effect, where the whole doesn't exist, even exists only as an indefinite multiplication of this single effect. Is it still possible consider as an insubordinative gesture the singularity? Or the real unsubordinative gesture is, for example, the regain of the value of the composition? And composition, I don't mean in the old school term, but I mean really for what means in his etymos, we can say is compositum, how you place something, the sense that you are able to structure posing something. In that sense, I recognize this attitude in the work of several artists, also very young one like Fujiwara or Alexander Tsing, who's an interesting artist from France. The idea that is possible evoke a sense of the world constructing what is possible to define an atlas, what is possible to define a complex system of sense, but is able to operate not only as an opposite contradiction, opposite contradictory, but like institutional critique was, but as an opposite contrary, So if the contradiction of white is everything, because this, whatever, the contrary of white is black, give a direction, you know? I think, but this is my position and I believe in it, the most strong way in which I can display my freedom as an artist is that constructing, evoking a different sense of the world. Who is able to place as an opposite contrary respect the cultural industry who determine it only as a multiplication of single effects, not related, not defined into a sense. So you understand that the exhibition, the concept of the exhibition, it could be the platform in which is possible to terminate this construction of a complex system of sense. Complex system of sense that should not be necessarily built up by myself, as I propose as a hypothesis of work and as a capability to be developed, is possible invite other people to collaborating to the production of ideas. I mean, many times there are different curators producing the exhibition. Why all this richness could not be brought into painting? There is any reason why it should not be done, you know? And this doesn't limit the possibility after to realize also the show. I'm sure if I realize this exhibition, I will discover other aspects. And this is gonna be productive. It's not but are placing in any kind of opposition. Like when exist several texts and several points of view in the regard of, for example, a show, no? We have different views, different perspectives. But it's exactly this void, and you don't go out from this void. There is a void between semiotic and hermeneutic. And if you are not a Greek, go to Benjamin, go to Gadamer and talk with them, you know? Okay, in so the sense, it's like that.
Perfect last words.
Yeah, exactly. But it's a productive void, you know, because I'm sorry.
Continue.
It's 10 o'clock, a beer, yeah.
So, it's working.
Yeah, he's a bit sad, but he doesn't understand the value.
Smile for a last goodbye, then I will stop.
What is his name?